What useless thing do you excel at? I can recall and recognize to this day people that I was in preschool with or have seen very briefly. When I was dating my ex, I would see someone that I recognized and would walk up to them and do the whole "aren't you so and so from blank." It gave them, my partner, extreme anxiety because strangers and what if I was wrong, but I am always right, every time. The most linguists would say is that there is evidence that a person starts learning certain aspects of the sounds of the language while they are in the womb. It's been shown that fetuses can detect when a different language is used outside the womb, for example. But that's all for processing sounds, and fetuses certainly won't be producing sounds in the womb. So, it's almost certainly just a coincidence that the child is able to produce loud clicks and has Xhosa ancestry. Like the other commenter said, English does not have clicks phonemically, but English speakers can and do regularly produce clicks for specific pragmatic functions. I have heard a radio piece about a linguistics study on children adopted from China. I think it was Hidden Brain. The gist was apparently babies in gestation are picking up language familiarity. Ears work in the womb, so Xhosa click sounds could have been picked up from the womb. Also, I'm Ethiopian, so I can make all the click sounds too. Also, another study uses the click sounds found in many languages to track the migration of man from sub-Saharan Africa. Edit to add scientific paper on this subject that suggests babies begin to learn individual sounds from 6 months of age to before birth. Truly fascinating. https://www.scienceatale.com/releases/2013/01/13013081203685.htm. Not sure if you're a linguist, but there's a significant gaps between comprehension and production. It's disingenuous to say that the two are immediately related when it comes to fetal studies, because there is up to a year's worth between the exposure to interpretable sounds and the baby babbling, the earliest stage of language production. At most, she would have an advantage in learning to distinguish from multiple clicks if she were to learn Xhosa later on. A similar pattern was seen in adopted Korean children in Chang et al. 2016-8. I am a linguist, and I say, cool, but seriously, I don't think it would have anything to do with the ethnicity. Clicks are found in various languages around the world. Although they are on the rare side, the TH sound in the English word the is also not found in a huge number of languages. So it would be like saying, my child can say TH really loudly. It's probably because they have English ancestry. Also, FYI, English uses and differentiates clicks as well. We just don't use them to make words. But for example, we differentiate the tut tut slash tsk tsk, I'm disappointed in you, click from the giddy up click, when you want a horse to start moving. I'm not a doctor, but I doubt it. I learned to do this just by practice. You put your tongue on the roof of your mouth pretty much anywhere, then pull down with the muscles in your throat and push up with your tongue, then click your tongue like normal and release. If you get an odd suction cup like sound, you're close. You can change the quality of the sound by moving your tongue and changing the shape of your lips. I saw a friend do it and was like, huh. So I just messed around and figured it out. Put the tip of your tongue behind your front teeth. Now bring your tongue back until you feel where the top of your mouth begins to open upwards towards your brain. Now rest the tip of your tongue at the crest of that curve, just before it starts to curve upwards. This is your starting point. Now, keeping your tongue there, make sure your tongue isn't in a pointed shape, but a relaxed shape. Imagine you're sucking from a straw. Even though you can't actually do it because sucking from a straw requires your tongue, you should feel like your tongue is creating pressure behind it. Make sure the top of your tongue, on the roof of your mouth, is creating a seal on top. Once you can feel the seal and the pressure behind your tongue, slowly lower your jaw so your tongue naturally loses its seal to the top. this will create a small noise. The next step is to keep the momentum of your tongue coming down and allow it to keep falling into the space just behind your bottom teeth. It should slam behind your bottom teeth. This will create the much louder sound. Do it all together and the original sound and the slap of the tongue on the bottom merge together and sound like one large click. Hopefully that helps. If it doesn't work, keep playing around with it, but do it by yourself because people get super annoyed by it. Here's the secret. Practice. In middle school I was bored and bounced my tongue off the roof of my mouth. Something like 100 times a day of practice. Took maybe less than a week to function. Once you hear that pop noise, it gets addicting to replicate it and make it louder. I told a friend how to do it and they promptly gave up after a few dozen tries because it wasn't working. I'm confident anyone can achieve the effect if they practice about 1,000 times. Managed to play ping pong with a classmate too. Basically the same as clicking your tongue, except press the same tip of your tongue into the roof of your mouth really hard and then try clicking. Once you get a louder click than normal, you'll find the right place on the roof of your mouth to place your tongue. Edit, adding in more because I can do it without thinking about it. Try widening your bottom jaw while you're performing that suction action. More edit. Tip of the tongue might be a bad descriptor. Front 1/4 to 1/3 of your tongue is better. Widen your mouth like you're smiling. Doesn't need to be a full smile. Place your tongue on the roof of your mouth right behind your teeth. You don't need your whole tongue, just the front half. When bouncing off the roof of your tongue, you can also try flicking your tongue back towards your mouth, but it's more of a bouncing, suction action, not quite a full flicking motion. I have a lot of trouble with my own age and birthday too, lol. When I was growing up, I had a friend that remembered my birthday better than I could and would answer it for me if I was asked when it was. I've had multiple experiences with answering incorrectly when doctors have asked when my birthday was and not realize until I get confused why they've just asked me about my birthday 4 times in a row. Lately I've been struggling a lot to remember my age and it almost always, awkwardly, takes me at least a few seconds to come up with my age when I'm asked. I was so amazing at this. Then I developed chemo brain and now I can only remember birthdays for people I knew before I got chemo unless I work really hard at it. It's one of the few things I wasn't able to rebuild. I can wake up on March 8th and know it's Tiffany and Jared's birthdays who I haven't seen since 2004 but my brother-in-law who I've known since 2007 is just vaguely summer and sometimes I can remember July. It just happened and I still have no clue what day that was. I can remember very specific conversations or things from books or training and other things but the ability to retain new birthdays is gone. RIP superpower. This is my mom. She can remember the birthdays of all her aunts and uncles, 8 I think, cousins, 15 plus taking into account both sides of the family, their kids, till the 6 only on my grand's side. She doesn't know about the other side. All her friends, random people she worked with, friends from childhood, my old friends from primary, high school, famous folks she likes, the list goes on. It's mental. Once I sat down and went through like everyone I could think of and I think there were only a handful of people she didn't know their birthdays, but she said she just hadn't ever been told it so there was nothing to remember. Meanwhile I know the birthdays of like 6 people in total and one of them is me. It was the dark times before the internet. We did anything and everything to be entertained. Joe found a funny looking stick. Come gather all ye all to wonder this delight that will help us pass at least 5 minutes. Someone could flip a coin into a glass. Jesus Christ, that's almost too much. Let me buy you a drink. Raza utterly destroyed a snag in the microwave at work today, making the place smell like a tannery. Bloody hell. That's the most riveting thing I have heard since I started my backbreaking work at the factory. Sometimes it got so bad we just talk with people, anybody, about anything. Margaret Thatcher's autobiography was released today. She stole me wee one's milk. ruined the country, made the working class bend over and get TSA'd, but goddamn it, if I'm going to talk about the weather one more goddamn time. I grew up without smartphones, resisted them until my 20s when I had to have one for work and subsequently became addicted to it. Anytime I'm stuck in waiting room or something for a while, I really regret that I've lost the ability to just entertain myself without scrolling through the same three apps over and over hoping something new and interesting pops up. I used to be able to entertain myself by just picking a spot to stare at on the wall or ceiling, and now it's like I can't be idle for more than 2 seconds before I reach for my damn phone. I'm the same. I was 27 or 28 when I got my first smartphone, a BlackBerry for work. It was 3 grams and I mostly only used it for the GPS. Then I got upgraded to an Android with a full screen. Then I put games on it. I got addicted and couldn't put the phone down. Anytime I had a moment, I was checking on my games. Once I got a new phone, I promised myself that I wouldn't put games on it. Not those kinds of games, anyway. It has solitaire and puzzle games for my kid to play, but I put a Reddit tape on it. Now I spend an absolutely ridiculous amount of time on this site. However, on long car rides as a passenger, or when sitting in a waiting room, I will purposefully leave my phone in my pocket and just look around. It's nice to take a break from the screen and just be sometimes. Purposefully leaving phone in pocket or something is a good idea. I've been trying to do that lately for the sake of my partner. She really doesn't like when I'm lost in my phone while she's driving, or while we're waiting on food or something. It was an issue with my last partner too, although then the issue was framed as yes, we have an open relation and yes, I encourage you to seek other partners, but you spend too much time on your phone talking to them. Now in this relationship, totally monogamous, so there are no Tinder matches to chat up or anything, but I still get caught up in just normal conversations on Reddit, Discord, whatever lol. So, now when we're driving somewhere or out to eat or just otherwise spending time together, I make sure to put that away, even if we're not talking about anything. And I've started applying to some of my own time as well. Like, I've got some bowel issues and spend a lot of time on the toilet. Normally I bring my phone, so sitting on the toilet for 30 minutes isn't so dull. But sometimes lately I've deliberately just left it in another room. It's a bit nice to have that time to just think. Well, depending on my mental state anyways. Networking, don't be so hard on yourself. We all are guilty of the same thing. We got used to instant gratification. What separates you from the rest though is that you are aware of it and you are embarrassed by how you've changed. You've identified the problem, not it's time to take action to change things. Who says scrolling through apps can't be a good thing? Try to restructure the things that appear in said 3 apps or get 3 new apps that make you more productive. My recommendations: Libby, Clubhouse, Reddit with new intellectual communities that you follow. Not trying to sound condescending, just trying to give some guidance. Thanks, you're absolutely right. I've at least stopped posting much on FB, so I don't have as many notifications from there that I feel the need to constantly check and respond to. Moved a lot more to Discord and them in some creative servers as I like to spend more time creating. Unfortunately, one of those servers has a bot with a virtual pet Tamagotchi type thing, and now I'm addicted to that lamel. TBH though, it's not the phone I'm addicted to, or even the instant gratification necessarily. I was addicted to computers long before the smartphones. It's just that without a smartphone, if I was away from a computer, I was actually away from a computer and forced to focus on my surroundings or at least just daydream or something instead. So I think really, it's just kinda enable the computer addiction I already had. Which itself is more of an addiction to distraction from reality, or rather an aversion to reality. a desire to escape. I get addicted to pretty much anything that provides a nice escape for me. The internet has always been great for that because I can hop around from community to community and participate at my leisure, and really take time to formulate my thoughts and type out everything I want to say. IRL I struggle in group settings because I often just kinda get drowned out and then withdraw inward from the start because group conversations often shift to things I have either zero interest in or significantly more interest than the rest of the group. Like sometimes I'll have a lot to add to a topic, but the group has moved on from it in like 2 seconds already. On the internet, I can respond to something from days ago and the context is still there. Oh, that reminds me of another thing. I'm double jointed and can bend all my fingers back 90 superscripto. I did not know that was not normal until I had been doing it for over 14 years. I found out when my brother saw me doing it and asked how I could do that. I told him that I just could, and then he tried and could barely bend them back at all. I thought something was wrong with his hands at first, lol. Also, most of my family can do taco tongue, but that's not really rare. TLDR, I'm double jointed and scared the crap out of my brother when I found out bending your fingers backwards isn't normal. Same here. Also, another one I can't explain is relaxing my muscles until they start to feed back almost a vibration. I can start it in my legs and then let it slowly go up my back to my arms. I can't do it for too long or I start to freak out from it. Word that you have these weird body functions you can't explain only to find out other have it too. I mean, it makes sense since we are all essentially the same. I'm not sure if this is the same thing or something similar, but I can induce this shaking that starts in my chest and travels outwards, and it rapidly intensifies within seconds until I can no longer sustain it. I can't really describe it very well, but it almost feels like I'm inducing short-lived nervousness, without the actual feeling of anxiety, and it wears me out if I do it too much in one sitting. I've never been able to identify what this could be. This is probably going to sound weird, but what you're describing reminds me of the work of vocal teacher Catherine Fitzmaurice. She teaches a technique called tremor work, in which you induce tremors in your body by flexing certain muscles. The fundamental purpose for her work is training actors and developing their voices. There are a lot of other uses in terms of emotional release and trauma held in the body. She developed her technique after studying somatic psychology. The tremor exercises can make you really exhausted, but are generally very relaxing afterwards. Ironically, while doing it, it induces body sensations that one might associate with anxiety or a panic attack. I feel you. Ear rumbling is apparently something that's not too rare in my friend group, but I absolutely know how you feel about explaining things to others that they can't understand. For me, the weirdest thing no one's ever understood was visual snow. People always thought I was crazy when I told them about seeing some kind of noise all the time. Like it's in a transparent layer above everything else I see. And I always found it weird that no one got what I was talking about. I was so happy and kinda relieved when Reddit told me what I experienced actually has a name, haha. Hey, wait, you might know this. I can do this and also love that I know what it is now. Very cool, lol. Also, personally, I believe connected somehow to how I can do this. Something else I can do, and I've never been able to explain how I can do it, but I can speed up and slow down my heartbeat just by thinking about it. I do it by somehow, I don't know, just sort of turning up or down some sort of nervous system thing. It seems to be focused in my high chest. It instantly seems to warm all my extremities as well. Before people think I'm bullshitting, I took a trip to Emerg last year for a leg thing. Not major, just enough. I had to sit in an emerg bed for an hour while they pulled a spike out of my leg. I was hooked up to a monitor and spent the time working on honing my talent, chatted with the doctor about it and showed him, but he didn't really comment back other than to say that's neat. He wasn't a talker, lol. I'd love to know an explanation for it. Thank you. I've been doing this to drown out the noise made by classmates, co-workers, people talking I don't want to listen to, and loud machine beeping my whole life, only 4 years for the last one, without even realizing that's why I was doing it, or there was a name for it. God bless you. Have an amazing life.